One, two, three, four. Palapalooza. Palapalooza. We're talking to ya. I'm Palapalooza.
Hey guys, thanks for listening to Palapalooza Podcast, episode 124. This week we check in with an uber talented local musician, Ryan Hiller, a solo artist who has recently collaborated with the singer of Rascal Flatts. He's staying very busy during COVID. He had a drive-through show with Whitney Shea that we'll talk about. He was nominated for a San Diego Music Award. A very talented guy. It was a pleasure chatting with him. Lyric, how are you doing? My daughter, my seven-year-old, she's home, schooled right now.
Great. I get to stay home. I can do homeschool here, and I've always wanted to do homeschool.
I am currently Mr. Cook at the Cook Residence. Thank you guys again for tuning in. Here we go, our episode with Ryan Hiller. Ryan Hiller, funk, soul, rock and roll from San Diego. How are you, my friend? Welcome to 2020.
Doing great. Yeah, thank you. I can't wait for 2021.
Dude, I know. But, you know, we have so much to talk about, and I'm so excited to talk to you. You've done a drive-in event, which we'll get to. You collaborated with someone rather famous and talented. We'll get to that as well. But just in general, COVID and the music scene, man, what are your thoughts?
Oh, man. Well, it just kind of, you know, I think for speaking on behalf of all musicians that I know, you know, and myself, obviously, it's just been a kind of reinventing yourself kind of year. I talked to some of my buddies and you know, girlfriends, everybody out there that's a musician is either writing music or practicing. There's a lot more time to do that. And because obviously gigs are kind of it's like the dark ages for gigs.
Right.
But there is a positive aspect to it, too, you know.
There always is. There certainly is. And what is that, Ryan?
For me personally, it's just been exploring other things. Definitely like just trying to take a bird's eye view of, you know, running the like being a full time musician. It's you're also running a business. So I've used this time on. I should have, you know, probably had a full length album like a couple of my friends have done, but instead I just use this time to kind of sharpen the business skills a little bit, because, you know, marketing and advertising, and I had to learn how to do payroll, which is wow. The most boring, horrible thing ever.
Are you doing this full time? Is this your primary source of income?
Yeah, actually today is my 37th birthday, and
wow, happy birthday, dude. 37?
Thank you. 37 times around the sun. Yeah. And I've never had a job, a regular job.
Right on. Good for you, dude.
Never had a W-2 or a boss. I've just been a full-time musician. I have a wife and two beautiful daughters. They're 2 and 4 years old.
Okay.
Yeah. My wife, she was working, but now, you know, she stays home to watch the kids. So there's a lot of pressure on my back, you know, to feed the fam and pay the mortgage and do that whole thing. So I think, but luckily music has enabled me to do that, you know, following my passion and I've had to be creative, you know, to figure out ways to make that happen. But very, very grateful to live in a place where we can do this, you know. It's, and there's many other people I know that are doing it as well. And that is the positive takeaway. So
that's incredible. Great for you, man. I DJ. I'm a musician. I play in a local band, but that doesn't make me any money. And I DJ events, and that's made me a really great living ever since up until March, you know, of 2020.
That's awesome. What do you play?
So I sing and play guitar in sort of a punk rock band. We're called Ready, Set, Survive. We were awesome. Nominated with you last year, bro. I know you're a San Diego music nominee for Best Singer-Songwriter. You know, so I tuned into the virtual stream San Diego Music Awards. What are your thoughts on that?
That was so cool. They were able to still do that, even though, you know, the in-person thing was shut down. And it's really cool how, you know, you know, the San Diego Music Awards and all, a lot of like the Belly Up and a lot of our local venues around town. We could go on and name them all, but we're all finding ways to keep the music alive, and streaming has been kind of a saving grace for me particularly. I've done some streaming gigs, you know, paid gigs during this time, and that's really helped financially keep things moving forward. However, I hate it.
Yeah, that's a good thing to get into. I mean, as a viewer and a fan, it's pretty cool, you know, watching your favorite musician. But yes, we did one in my backyard, and staring into a camera instead of 100, 200 fans is very different and very, it's a challenge, right?
Yeah, I've been doing some, you know, some corporate ones and, you know, getting paid some good money. And there's like, so one of them I did on Microsoft Teams, and there's like, I think 400 or 500 people there. I mean, you see the number of people, wow. And you're like, wow. Now, how many of those people are really watching? Number one. Number two, they have all got their screens and their microphones off. So you really just feel like, wow, am I really playing to 400 people, or am I just like playing to my computer screen? It's just so, I don't know. And then at the end of every song, like instead of hearing applause or feeling an energy from a room, it's just like I'm just staring at the wall of my studio. I mean, I'm glad that we're all coming together, and some of these clients and, you know, other music fans out there are supporting us artists and, you know, trying to keep the lights on, so to speak. But God, I can't wait until we're with each other again, because music is, it's the universal language, but it requires us to kind of be together and feed. There's an energy that's involved with a live performance that's just, you cannot recreate with a streaming show.
Totally agree. There's an exchange of energy, and you know, this is a quote unquote new normal. We're hearing that a lot, but I certainly hope it isn't.
Yeah.
You mentioned corporate events. Is that sort of where your primary source of income is? I know how much money there can be in corporate events.
Absolutely. I'd say the private event world is where I make my money.
Yep.
And then I, you know, that's what keeps me, you know, that's how I feed the family and pay the bills. And then as far as like, you know, where the heart and soul is, it's the live original shows.
Right on.
So I've got 3 albums out. I've actually got 4 albums. Well, I guess 2 of them are EPs. So 2 full length albums and 2 EPs.
Get it right, man.
I know. Get some hate mail. Hey, did you know the difference between a full length album and an EP? But anyway,
what is the difference? I think it has to do with the amount of time, right?
EP. I think it has to do with like a record. So like LP is I think it stands for long play or something, and an EP is extended. I don't know. They stand for something, but it has to do with how much fits on the actual product. So now that everything's digital, it's kind of irrelevant. But yeah, my 2 EPs have 6 songs each on them. How It Works was the last one I did.
How it works, nobody knows. Gears keep on turning, but nothing will show. A certain direction wherever life will go. Said how it works, well, I just gotta know.
And then the one before that was called The Pure Project.
Living in the middle, to put me in the middle of where we ought to be. Well, don't you worry about an answer, there's a way much faster, but you gotta have money to play. Well,
no. The Pure Project was, I just kind of did that here at Signature Sound Studio with a local engineer, Ian Sutton, and I didn't have any money. I got some killer local musicians to play on it, though. Kevin Cooper, who I still play with, great bass player. He's probably one of the top called guys in town. And so he awesome. Played on that record, and I got some, I got a bunch of people to sit in, but it was the kind of thing where we went in the studio at 11 p.m. and worked until 4 a.m., you know, and yeah. So it was that kind of thing. And then the guy who did the artwork on that did the dragon for Stone Brewing.
Wow.
So that was like back 2008, 2009, yeah. And he's like, yeah, well, I just got this gig. And I'm like, wow, that dragon's pretty cool. Would you do my Would you do my CD cover? So for any of your listeners, if you go to Spotify and you check, or Amazon, or wherever you go for music, iTunes, look up Pure Project and you'll see that album cover is, that's Stone Brewing. That's their artist.
That's really cool.
Yeah. And then how it works, I did with this producer I met up in Hollywood. His name is Andrew Williams. He's an awesome producer. He's got an incredible, you know, discography. But that was where I really learned a lot about what you can do with modern technology. Because he basically, when I went to interview with him, he just had like this tiny little room. And I was just shocked to hear that all the stuff that he was coming out with, he just did there, you know. So that was like a kind of like a little college course in recording, working with him on that album. And and then my most recent one was with the local record label Pacific Records.
Of course.
And that one was very similar. I did about almost, so I built, after I did the How It Works record, I built my own studio. So I've got here in my home here in Claremont, San Diego here, I've got a separate like studio out back and with a little sound room, and did about 95% of that record there, and then we just mixed it with Pacific Records and actually did the drums in a live room as well. But it's pretty cool how, you know, I think that's probably how most independent artists are doing it these days.
Yeah, there's definitely a lot of DIY and a lot to learn with technology advancements and everything. Who runs Pacific Records? It's on the tip of my tongue.
Yeah, Brian Witkin.
Witkin, okay.
Yeah,
cool, and I'm the on the website right now.
Yeah, so he's kind of the business, you know, the business guy, and the dude I worked with mostly, Patricio Pixley, we worked together, and we had actually crossed paths years ago. I moved here from New Orleans after Katrina, and I was, I just basically Katrina hit and I was in a band in New Orleans. We had toured the country a few times, and I just literally got a map, and I was like, what's the nicest city that we toured in? And I was like, San Diego. We played Winston's, I think, in 2003 or 2004, and it was just packed full of people, and everybody was so nice. And I served for the first time that day, cooking it up big time at the pier. People were really nice, and I just had a great experience, and it stuck with me. And when that storm hit, I packed up a trailer with a bed and a desk. I think that's all I owned at the time. And I showed up to San Diego. And the first job I got was teaching guitar lessons. And Patricio was, we were just doing the same, I think working for the same place or something like that. So that's where I first met him. And then, and I guess like 10 years later or 15 years later, however long it was, we started making an album together. So it was pretty cool.
Incredible. That's a great story, man. And then you met your wife out here in San Diego or in New Orleans?
Oh, no, out here. So I came out here to San Diego and my wife, this is funny. So I, you know, had to kind of start all over again music wise and was just teaching guitar lessons. And one of the girls I was teaching guitar lessons to, she had a younger sister that had a babysitter. And I was telling her parents, I was like, yeah, I got these concert tickets. I can't find a date. They're like, why don't you take out her babysitter? So I took her out on a blind date, and here we are.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's incredible. So Katrina, as awful as it was, obviously, was sort of a blessing in disguise for you.
Absolutely. I think all, you know, everything kind of happens. I'm one of those that think, I think there's a little bit of fate involved in the things that come around, and it's all good, you know, it's all.
Right. I do too, man. I really do. As long as you have your eyes open and you're in present time and you're there to capture it and take advantage of those opportunities, you know?
Exactly. And not to get too beaten down when life kicks you in the balls, you know?
Yeah. Which happens.
Yeah, definitely. You just got to keep positive if you can, and just keep moving forward. I think, yeah, because then things eventually work out, you know. So I notice a lot of similarities with the whole COVID thing and Katrina. It seems there's like, I don't know. It feels, but this whole this year feels even a little bit crazier because it's, you know, it's happening everywhere. You know, not just in one city.
Yeah, I feel like it's a giant test.
Yep.
You know, and now Facebook is stopping streams, and it's like, what is happening here? Are they, you know, is the planet trying to kill musicians?
I know.
I'm kidding, of course, but there's a lot of obstacles, and it feels like a test in a lot of ways.
It really is for musicians, I think. I don't know, like, one of my favorite things to do, I mean, is this what we're doing right now, talking to other musicians. I, especially in March and April, I mean, I love my wife to death, and I love my parents and my brothers, but I can't really, the people that really have gotten me through this are some of my fellow colleagues, musicians that are working musicians that have a similar situation, and it's like, yeah. Man... It really is scary because our livelihoods are totally threatened. But talking right. to one another and strategizing and, you know, it's very therapeutic. And it's not right. just musicians. I mean, I'm sound guys and
sure.
talent bookers and you know, booking agents and event planners and coordinators. Right. I mean, the list goes on. There's so much totally. Into... a live event, and everybody in that space is totally, I don't know if we can cuss on this, but, fucked.
Yeah. Let's drop our first F-bomb. It's such a supportive community, too. You mentioned relying on colleagues and other musicians. I don't know if you want to shout out a few, but there's so many people here in San Diego that help, you know, and that, you know, like Tim Mays of the Casbah and all the venues here doing their streams, and Tim Piles, of course, and podcasters. And it's seriously the kind of thing that I could probably get choked up and teary-eyed if I talked about for long enough, because it really is just an amazing community for music, and you picked the right city, bro. You really did.
I agree. And you know, it's a diverse city, and there's a lot of opportunity for a lot of different kinds of artists, you know.
Right.
And what you, the names you just mentioned, I mean, we could go on and on. That's how awesome it is here. Yeah. Another difference between San Diego and other cities, like I was going to go to LA and, you know, some of the bigger cities, obviously the business is a lot larger, but it's so much more, I think it felt to me, it's more of a cutthroat kind of vibe. For instance, like as a guitar player, you know, down here in San Diego, I feel like I could call anyone to sub and like, no, yeah. you know, without any sort of fear of, oh, they're going to, you know, they're going to want to take my gig, or, you know, we're all just all right. there for each other. New Orleans was very similar, actually, too. I mean, you cool. just people call each other, hey, come sit in, come, you know, it's just right. more of a communal thing. And there's so much work. There's enough work to go around. So that's kind of the energy I get from San Diego. And that's why I'm still yeah. here. You know, I did not think I was going to be here this long, and I don't have any real desire to go anywhere else. So.
It's a great city. I mean, you mentioned corporate events, and it's a destination city. You know, there's a lot of tourism. A lot of people come here. A lot of people throw weddings, 30,000 weddings a year. I would say that's my industry. I'm sure you do a lot of weddings, and we'll have to team up, dude, actually.
We have to do that. Yeah, it's so funny because you mentioned you're a DJ. You're a guitar player and a singer, and then you DJ. So, like, yeah. back in the day, I was like, sorry DJs out there, but I was totally hating on DJs because I was so jealous. Like, you know, you guys just go in there with, you know, playing other people's music and you get huge crowds. And anyway.
No, I hear that. I'm both, dude. So I see, but I see the demand for DJs, and I see the amount of money that you can make doing that, especially for like weddings and corporate.
And that's exactly what happened. So basically what happened with me is I was at a gig. And I was at a wedding gig, actually, and, you know, I brought all the, you know, speakers and mixers and microphones and everything to facilitate the first part, the cocktail hour and the ceremony, yeah. and then all of a sudden, a DJ comes in, sets up the same amount of equipment, and as for all the musicians listening,
you know, that's the work. That's really a big part of the work is lugging that shit around. Once right. once you get you know, to just show up and play, it's a game changer. But anyway,
I was thinking about that the other day. Like, God, could I pay someone $100 to load in and load out for me? You know, $100 or something. You know, yeah, it really is a pain, especially when you start getting older.
Yeah, and then it makes your 2 hour gig a 4 hour gig, or maybe exactly. even a 5 hour gig door to door. So anyway, yeah. I saw the DJ do that, and that very night I went home and I bought my first set of turntables, and I was like, it's like 10 years ago. So I've been DJing this whole time, and now I have, you know, I was just an idiot. There is something to it, and of course you could just go and press play and pause and fade in and out, but once you start right. kind of getting into it more and. You know, I really have a respect for the old school guys who drop vinyl goodness. And they've got to time it perfectly and, you know, memorize their keys, and they've actually got crates full. I mean, now it's all insanity. Evolved and you can auto detect BPM and right. key signatures and everything else. But I mean, it's really fun. I encourage any musician out there who hasn't tried it to just go download a musician DJing, you approach it differently than a kid right. who's just starting out, and it's more like a video game, you know, for some people. Yeah. But if you already know and understand music, it's actually kind of fun. You can remix stuff, and yeah,
it is. It's cool. It's a great career, and like you, I've been able to make a living doing that for quite a few years. I've worked a lot of other jobs as well, but. You have to be comfy on the mic. You have to know what you're doing for weddings, for sure. If a technical issue comes up, there's, like you said, it can be pretty involved. But it's fun. I mean, at the end of the day, you're a part of someone's best day, and it's for the most part a pretty lively and positive experience.
Absolutely, that's my little niche for you know what I notice with weddings. So I actually have a business. It's called SoCal Wedding Music, and okay. one of the hats that I wear, and that evolved because from the story I just previously mentioned is people hired me, they heard me playing guitar at a bar or, you know, saw me somewhere, and then they'd want me to do just a small part of their wedding, but they're like, hey, for dancing, you know, we kind of need a whole band, and I've got that too, but the problem with a good wedding band or a good corporate band is they're expensive, and most normal people don't have that kind of a budget, you know, for their wedding. So I was like, why don't I just do the live for the, you know, the important parts, and then maybe give you a little cocktail hour dinner kind of music like you would hear at a restaurant kind of thing, and then fire up the turntables for when people are ready to dance, and kind of solve that problem. And now there's a few people out there doing that as well. And it's great because it's a way for us to monetize our passion and actually, you know, continue doing what we love to an extent, you know?
Absolutely, man. That's very smart of you, for sure. Ceremony, cocktail, and then fire up the turntables. Yeah, you're a one-man show.
One-man show, baby.
Yeah, well, we'll definitely have to exchange. My company is TNT Entertainment.
Oh, I've seen you guys around. Yeah.
Yeah, we advertise and we're on Yelp and all over the place. So we'll link up, dude.
Dude, we got to link up. There's only a few of us doing that around, you know, really. I mean, there's a couple of my,
there's quite a few DJs.
Yeah, there's a lot of DJs out there. A lot of DJs. And then there's some really great bands, like full bands.
Yep.
But everybody's got to find a niche in this business if you're going to do it full time, you know. And there's nothing wrong with having a day job, because really where all of our hearts are, I'm speaking kind of just from my observation of talking to all musicians, I think where all of our hearts are in is touring and playing live shows, live original music is like,
right.
That's really where it's at. It's just this, I don't know, you want to talk about the music business? I just feel like it's, you just mentioned live, like Facebook canceling streams and, you know, and trying to make it on the road, just doing original tunes when you're mostly playing for the door in a city you've never been to, and you're trying to get your name out there. I mean, the common denominator, I feel like, for most people trying to do that for a full-time career is you either have to have, like, a pretty big record deal, so you got to have some money, you know, funding that, or you have to have a good cushion of money. It's almost impossible to, like, unless someone's got some, unless you have some other things to add, to, like, just get your guitar and go on the road and try to come home with money still left in your bank account without any right. other support networks, you know?
Right.
And I'm speaking from experience, so.
Yeah. You certainly have more experience on the road and in the industry than I do. And I couldn't tell a musician how they make it in this day and age. I've talked to so many bands like POD and Unwritten Law and Sprung Monkey who are still sort of scraping by with as big of a name that they have, you know, and not to hate on them. It's just the industry has changed so much. I feel like what you're doing is probably the most potential corporate covers.
Yeah. But you know what I do? I throw in my original music. So, I'll do covers to, I use the covers to like lure the fish and then I'll
yep.
play a couple originals and they'll be like, oh, they'll clap. And what was that song? Oh, it's my original song. Here, why don't you check this out? I got a CD here. And now, honestly, yep. I just give the, now CDs are so antiquated. No one's using them. I just give them, right. pretty much give them away. You know, for the most part, it's not really about that. It's just spreading. You know, totally. Try to get people to land on your Spotify and listen, and really listen to your songs. But the way yeah. I feel like the music business works is you got to have a ton of money to distribute and market and advertise. And the only people who, and it's still the record labels that control that, the big ones. The indie labels really can't get you on the radio unless they've, you know, unless they're a bigger indie label, of course. You know, Pacific Records is kind of a smaller local label. You get some of these big, you know, bigger indie labels, and then at that point, they're probably still, they might have an affiliation with the larger one, but that's sure. when you start seeing things shift. Is I was talking about like the Taylor Swift stories, and don't hate on me if this is not 100% accurate. This is what I've been told, but I've been told it from a couple different sources, so I think it might be true. It was basically, you know, her dad was like super wealthy and invested in her first album, and I heard something like $500,000 to $1 million or something, like some serious dough. Yeah. and then had a distribution deal through whatever he was doing with Best Buy, Walmart. This is back when CDs were still a thing. Flooded them with all of her newly recorded CDs, and then they hired teams across the country to go buy them all up. And then when that happened, they basically, her dad made her go gold, basically. And then the offers came. She got on, once she went gold, she had all this, you know, momentum and buzz, and just right went straight to the stations. So
that's interesting. That's kind of brilliant. You know,
yeah.
You buy your way into going gold just to put you on the map.
Yeah. And I mean, look at what a great investment. I mean, if yeah. you were her dad, I would do that for my daughters if I could, you know, what a great investment. But it goes right. to show you there, you know, for all the listeners out there and all the musicians that don't have that kind of access, there are like some of the people who make it that big. There's help before they started, before they picked up the guitar. There were opportunities, and it's really tough if you've written some great songs and you're just on the road, you know, without capital behind you. It's tough, but people do it all the time. There's still amazing stories being told
right.
of people, you know, making it. So. It's not saying don't do it, but don't get hard on yourself when, well, and then that's what I tell myself too. It's like, I've been doing this 37 years. Like, yeah. I'm so happy and grateful I get to pick up my guitar and feed my family with it. But even if it's not the way that, you know, I would prefer to do it, I'm still very happy that this city and the people around this city and, you know, there's opportunity here for us to do what we love.
Absolutely, man. What were your influences getting into music? I hear a little like Stevie Ray Vaughan in your playing.
I'd say probably one of my biggest influences, absolutely. Stevie Ray Vaughan, definitely. You know, when I was a kid, my parents played. So I kind of was raised on like the American Songbook, and I still heavily influenced by like Van Morrison.
Yeah.
Bob Seger and, you know, Bob Dylan, all those old folk kind of, you know, I guess now you call it like adult contemporary or oldie kind of music. Then I discovered Jimi Hendrix, and Jimi Hendrix led to Stevie Ray Vaughan, and then that whole, you know, blues rock, Clapton, you know. And then I got into jazz in high school because it was the only kind of place I could play my guitar at school. Yeah. Became a total jazz band nerd. And then I ended up, you know, going to New Orleans to study it. But the whole time I was in New Orleans and studying jazz, I wasn't really playing jazz out in public. It was mostly like in Salt Lake City, where I was born. I went to high school in Park City, Utah. And I was in this awesome, like, hip-hop jazz group, kind of like The Roots, you know? There was a stand-up bass and an MC. And it was kind of just... but we had some killer gigs, like opened up for Black Eyed Peas and played the 2002 Winter Olympics and opened up for John Scofield. And it was really a cool project. And then when I moved to New Orleans, I was doing a lot of like, I played in the gospel choir. I was the only white boy in like a congregation of 2,000 people.
Nice.
But I'd attribute that experience probably one of the most educational, real world, like,
yeah,
those musicians that play in those Southern gospel churches, and even some out here I've heard too, the music is just so intense, and there's so many chord changes and rhythmic things happening, and there's no music. I don't think I ever saw anyone reading anything. It's you know the tune or you don't know the tune, and you've got your ears open and you're following the leader.
Yeah. It looks like we're heading into the orange tier. We're late September here, and I personally don't like all these color codes, and, you know, I don't like all the government control, man. I get it.
It's so hard. It's so hard to know, like, but I think that, like, some people are doing some really, innovative things. Like, I got a buddy, Jimmy Langley, who, he owns some restaurants up in Pacific Highlands. And there's a big courtyard in the middle there. And I'll give them a shout out too. It's Death by Tequila and Woku and Breakfast Republic. And in between all those restaurants, so they all have patios outside and they're all complying with all the, you know, the governmental things. But in the courtyard there, they've got a space and now they're starting to book live music. So
cool.
You know, people are out there and being social distancing and doing their thing, but they're together also, and it's a big enough space where you can get food and you can listen to live music. And so if enough places see that model and how well it's working, I think we're gonna have music come back, because it draws people to that place. You know, people who are on the other side of the shopping center, they see people over there and they're listening to good music and they're eating and drinking, they're gonna be attracted to that. And when other businesses see that that's working, I think it'll catch on and musicians will start seeing a resurgence of work.
I think it's all about being outdoors for the most part, right? And fortunately, throughout the summer it worked. We're in San Diego, but in the fall that's going to be a little more difficult once it starts quote unquote raining here in San Diego.
Raining for the 10 days a year it does. I hope we get rain. How long has it been since it's rained?
Usually, I don't know. Last Thanksgiving rained.
yeah, a year ago.
So November, you know, it usually starts in November. But, you know, I did my first wedding to release some personal information. I did my first wedding last weekend, the end of September, since March. My company had a couple, but I was trying to stay sort of cautious for the household. And it was not COVID friendly. I'm not going to shout out the venue, but they're getting away with it because it's an indoor-outdoor venue. And all of the windows they have these like sliding doors that open up. So it's kind of indoor-outdoor, but you know, no one was wearing masks. Everyone was dry humping on the dance floor. You know, it's...
Now, was dry humping with a mask dangerous?
I guess not. Maybe not, dude. I don't know. But it, yeah, I know. I saw this thing the other day where this guy's taking video. It's like this viral meme, and there's a couple on the dance floor making out, and they both have masks on. You know, they're just going, they're going at it, and they both have these masks on. It's a bizarre year.
Yeah, I feel like that could be like some sort of like thing that if you Google, you might find some things you're not. No, maybe you are looking for.
Right.
Dry humping with a mask. Could be an album name.
Yeah. I'll be honest, I think you're one of the most full-time musicians I've had on the podcast. I know you performed with Whitney Shea. We can talk about that. I believe she's full-time. I could be wrong.
She is. Yeah, she is.
Yeah, I want to talk all about that, dude. That was a drive-in concert at the Del Mar Fairgrounds, so we're talking about adapting. How was that for you, dude? Like playing to a bunch of cars.
So yeah, I just want to give Josh Jose from the Acoustic Spot a huge shout out because he took one of the biggest risks and made one of the biggest like moves during this time. He's got some big balls, some big cojones for doing this because it took a big, you know, investment from him. He's in a similar situation. He is both Whitney, Rebecca, my booking agent for a lot of local, in normal times he books like a lot of the restaurants around town. And then he also books some corporate events. Mm. But yeah, so he basically said, he hit me up and he said, you know, what do you think about, you know, getting a big outdoor space and then doing a drive-in concert. And I was like, man, it sounds amazing, but I don't know how it's going to work, dude. I never done one. Like,
right.
Logistically, how are people going to hear it? And what's the sound going to be like? Mm-hmm. And long story short, he hired this great local sound guy, Melvin Cannon. Mm-hmm. Incredible. He's got awesome gear. And he and his team set up this great stage with great sound. They were able to stream the sound to FM or to some station. And the turnout was insane. I mean, I just couldn't believe it was like one of the best shows I've played in a long time, even before COVID. I mean, the turnout was amazing. Right. And then I opened up for Whitney Shea with my buddy. I just did my duo looping kind of. Played a lot of original music, played a couple covers and high energy show. And it just was the energy was like electric. After every song, cars would honk their horns and flash their lights. God. And some people, each car had like their own little space so they could have a chair and table, you know, and they could have some drinks and, you know, people were distanced from one another and people could dance in their own little space, you know,
on top of their car.
And it just was, it was cool. It was really cool. It was probably the coolest thing ever. And now I've seen that. And I got to play with Whitney Shea. She put on an awesome show. She had her entire band.
Awesome.
There.
Very cool.
We did a couple tunes together and it was just a very warm, cuddly, happy, you know, love fest basically. And and I think it's catching on around the country. I mean, if you Google it now, there's like a big, you know, major label kind of outfit booking. I think the Beach Boys are doing one and like they've got all these big, big names doing them now.
Yeah.
But Josh he took the first leap and he succeeded. So I hope he gets some more opportunities to do that because it was, you know, with other artists, give some other artists some an opportunity to experience that because it was definitely the medicine that we all needed.
Yeah, I saw the one with Switchfoot and Hyrie at Petco Park. I brought my family there.
Oh, how was that?
It was cool. Kind of like you said, you know, flashing lights and honking horns and everyone had their space. A cool thing to experience. I don't know how long that is going to last, if that's going to be a nostalgic kind of thing or if it will continue on forever. What are your thoughts on that?
I think that depends on
COVID.
This pandemic.
COVID.
COVID is really the, man. I mean, I think if there was a vaccine and everybody was immediately danger free, and there was no risk at all, I think everybody that I know would say, hey, I want to be next to you. I want to dance with you. I want to, you know, if you're listening to a, you know, Metallica, I Want to Be in a Mosh Pit with You, yeah. throwing each other around. Like, people don't, I don't think people like being so apart from each other all the time.
It's not normal, dude. It's not good. It's not healthy. I think on the other side of the spectrum too, though, I think once this all settles down and the vaccine is out, I think you're still going to have that small percentage that's just like cautious of crowds.
Yeah.
For a while, dude, you know, for years, if not forever, you know, that's just my own insight.
I think you're 100% right. There's going to be a psychological blowback from this whole thing.
Yeah.
But I think it's a smaller percentage than you think. Cause I mean, now I just going outside, I was out running errands today, this morning before the call. And I mean, traffic is coming back in San Diego, you know, waiting in traffic. I know. I couldn't believe it.
Dude, we got what we asked for. No one wanted traffic.
Yeah.
You know, no one wanted crowds. We got what we asked for, man.
For the first couple, you know, like March and April, like San Diego was, it must have been for those old school folks, you know, that's probably what it was like back in the day. You just cruise down the road, you know, cruise up and down the 5 or on the PCH and there's just... You're not waiting at all, you know, and the 805 where I live, it can just be a total nightmare disaster. Like, that's why I'm not living in LA. And then I move here and then I got to sit on the 805 and you're just, I mean, it's like LA, you know, you're moving. And the other day, I guess this morning I saw it. And then I think 2 days ago I saw it. It's just coming back. So I think people are, things are, you know, it's starting to normalize slowly. You know, we'll see how long that lasts. But for musicians, we've got a band-aid with the drive-ins. We've got a band-aid with the streaming. There's a huge support network. People are having little backyard parties. There's definitely a little market for like what are they calling them? Micro events.
Micro events, you know? Yeah. I've seen that. I've seen planners. Yeah, I've seen planners. On Instagram post about micro events. And there is live music. You know, I'm seeing bands playing. It's typically, I can't name the venue, but recently a friend's band of mine played in an outdoor setting and everyone was seated at tables. It's not ideal, but there are events out there. And again, I just DJed a wedding, 100-person wedding last weekend.
I was on the East Coast too, unfortunately for a funeral, but we were, I took my wife and kids and we just kind of, you know, we did some more outdoors stuff like, you know, state parks and hiking and stuff like that. But I noticed that night, you know, in some of these, we kind of went from, you know, all up and up the East Coast, and I noticed it's really different out there. There's bands playing inside bars and people not wearing masks. And
oh, wow.
So I think California is definitely on the stricter, more right. cautious side as compared to the rest of the country too. So
I figure that might
if
be
that's
the case,
an indicator, though. we can watch that and see what happens. Cause if, you know, things don't get worse, hopefully we'll see things, you know, more opportunities for live events coming up. But it kind of all depends on fate, like we were talking about in the beginning, you know, whatever the test is. I guess we're still in the middle of it, so we can't see our answers yet.
Right. Maybe there's a reason for this, you know, maybe it's giving us a greater appreciation for things. Maybe it's helping the environment by cutting down emissions from vehicles, you know, maybe there is a greater purpose. Who knows?
Yeah.
It still sucks, but, you know, trying to stay optimistic.
Yeah, and we're not going to know, you and I probably won't know until it's all said and done 10, 20 years from now when some smart people actually have a way to analyze exactly what the cause and effect was. But there's definitely going to be both negative and positive.
Right. I hope we look back on this and see it as a very brief time in history. I heard one scientist say that we'll look back in 10 years on 2020 and it will look good. Because of the way that global warming is progressing and the environment that these are actually the good days. So, you know, I can't quote.
I hope not.
I know.
I hope it doesn't get worse. Oh, man. I mean, I have to say, you know, I've had the scariest times of my life, you know, as far as like, what am I going to do as the husband and father, you know, how am I going to, you know, I don't have a 9-to-5 that was able to pay me benefits, and I couldn't work at home from Zoom and still get a paycheck. So I really had to figure things out, and it was scary, and I don't want to do that again.
Right.
But that was the negative, but the positive was, you know, I was home. One of my really wealthy clients were moving, and they gave me this incredible piano, and I've never really learned how to play the piano. So I learned every song, Disney song there is known to man. And I just sang them and played them for my little girls every day. And as nerdy and dorky as that sounds, I mean, that was, if I got to look back at COVID, that's what I'm going to remember that as one of the shining moments, you know, that quality time, you know.
Absolutely.
When you're working and kind of in the thick of it all, there's not a lot of time for that, but it was.
Totally.
So, you know, yeah. We got to look at some of these positives if we're gonna keep moving forward, you know.
There's certainly the silver lining, and me and you are kind of in similar boats. I have a 7-year-old. I'm homeschooling her, you know, and I think I'll look back fondly on these times, as crazy as they've been. And yeah, hey, props to you, man, for stepping up and getting the business training. You certainly already had the talent, and I think that's extremely helpful. Obviously, bro, in the music industry, you do have to have the talent and the songwriting skills. So good job, dude. That's very inspiring. You make me want to step it up a notch.
Thank you. Oh, it sounds like you already have, man. I think the homeschooling, you just one up to me because
yeah, bro, what you got on that, Ryan? No.
Yeah, I think that's those one common denominator, since my girls are too little.
Yeah, 2 and 4, you said, right?
Yeah, so my daughter will go into kindergarten next year, but I think all these parents that I'm friends with that have kids, and they're the teachers now, and they're just like, oh my God, this, we have got to go back to school. This is, it's because they got to figure out how to, you know, how are you supposed to work your 9-to-5 job,
right,
telecommunicating from on Zoom, and then also be facilitating your kids'
right
schoolwork, you
right
know? And I guess these teachers are getting, like, instead of 2 pages of homework, they're giving them like 10 pages a night. So the parents are just ripping their hair out. So you're stepping it up too, my friend. I mean, we're all in this together.
Thank you, buddy. It's been good talking with you, bro. We have to talk about the singer of Rascal Flatts. I saw on social media that you collaborated with him. Is it Gary Levox?
I think it's Levox.
An amazing vocalist, and you know, it had to have been a great opportunity and experience for you.
It's really a very crazy story. I don't know. I'm going to try to cut the whole thing down. But basically, I got a call from my buddies over at Gigtown, which is another great local booking agency too here in town. And they were tasked with a very unique situation. This a client. I'm going to try to be very careful when I say here.
Well, they were basically looking for musicians to back up Gary, right? For the most
exactly,
part.
Exactly. But they didn't understand, and I'm sure any, again, musicians can have been in the situation where they wanted a lot that they didn't understand, like the logistics of how to make it work. So basically they thought like, well, here, listen to the album and then just play it. And I had 4 days to do this. People who listen to my music, they probably don't hear a lot of Rascal Flatts in it, you know, but.
Right. Country. Yeah. It was different for you. So how many songs in 4 days?
9 songs in 4 days, verbatim.
You got your dream team, right? Together.
Yep. Kevin Cooper, the bass player mentioned earlier. And then my drummer who I've been playing with for years, Jeff Burgess. I said, guys, can you do this? We are going to have to literally just, starting tomorrow, like, hash this out in the studio. So we did, you know, we charted all the tunes, and we had 4 days to do it, and then we got on stage, and he just got off the plane, and
wow,
and he was the nicest guy that you could possibly imagine. He's making a lot of money to do this, you know, a lot of money. And
was that a private event? Was there a crowd there? Was it a stream?
It was a private event. It was a wedding. It was actually a wedding.
A wedding.
Yep.
Okay, and got it. Wow.
Yeah. Right. Yep. For a billionaire client.
Wow.
Basically, he gets off the stage, you know, he's got a rider, you know, and he's used to doing these huge arena shows. You know, he's a huge platinum selling artist. And the only thing he put on his rider was Grey Goose and Diet Mountain Dew. That was it. That was it. That's so I saw him. There was like a table with Grey Goose and Mountain Dew. I'm like, that's all you wanted, dude? But
crazy.
They also put him up. I mean, they flew him up out, I'm sure, in a nice plane, and he got to stay in a beautiful place. And but he just got to walk off right. the plane, and our band was ready. And I've got some footage. You just reminded me. I got a one of the tunes. We kind of put our own, like, the whole time I was preparing the songs, I got to talk to his MD, his musical director, and make sure, you know, I would like record a little bit of rehearsal, say, hey, what do you think? And he'd give us a couple tweaks. And it's just hard because we kind of play, our band is more of a funky kind of a feel. We put a lot of kind of groove and kind of backbeat, and we had to really watch that because pop country is, the musical director said, it's like, you got to go long. And what he meant is like, you got to just play the chord on the downbeat and just hold it for the entire measure. No accents, no rhythmic variation. It's just, so that was actually a challenge. Playing so simple was hard for me. When it came time to play and my nerves kicked in, I just ended up kind of playing.
Yeah.
I was going to just do my thing anyway. But he liked it. And we did the show. He was supposed to leave. And he said, all right, you know, great playing, blah, blah, blah. And then he told me, he kind of whispered, he's like, hey, man, I want to keep playing with you.
Yes.
But then he left and he never came back. So I was like, oh, we just, we got the Nashville no. You know, that's like kind of an infamous way of, they're so nice, but they're just like.
Oh, gotcha.
Yeah.
Right.
But anyway, so we packed up the stage. He comes back down. He's like, what are you guys doing?
Oh, shit.
So we had to repack. We packed the stage all the way back up. And we ended up jamming like all night.
Wow. For this wedding?
Yeah, just hanging out. Yeah, we just hung out. He was the nicest guy. Really one of the nicest people you can meet. So totally down to earth. And it was just a great experience.
What songs did you jam out? Were you playing some covers or?
All covers, yeah. Just you name it, like Black Crowes.
Right.
We're playing Lynyrd Skynyrd, you know, just mostly like party, you know, party dance music. And he was, you know, he was like singing background. A lot of it, he was just singing background for me.
Okay.
Or just like singing with me, you know, dancing on the stage. I mean,
wow.
And the crowd was totally digging it. And it was definitely, it was really a wow kind of, is this happening kind of thing.
I bet. How many people
were
at that wedding?
And then the next day I was back to Microsoft Teams playing into the computer screen.
Dude, what a cool experience. How many people were at that wedding?
It was small. It was intimate. It was maybe 40.
Wow. And I would assume the Rascal Flatts songs included their hits, My Wish, Life is a Highway.
Yep.
Right?
Yeah, the set was like, I think the big thing was the couple wanted God Bless the Broken Road for the first dance. And then it was, then we did My Wish for the parent dances. And then we opened it up with all the hits. Yeah. And then
wow.
The one that I'm going to put up, maybe I'll try to do it this week. It's called Praying for Daylight.
Yeah.
And it was kind of, we did like a funky version of it. It was really cool. We worked with it on the MD, totally unlike all their other tunes. And that one turned out really,
that's right.
It was a really fun one. Unfortunately, we didn't get any footage of the jam session. That was where I felt like all the magic happened because we weren't, the band, including myself, we didn't have our heads buried in the charts. So we kind of opened it up and just had fun. And
that's cool.
And the crowd liked it too. I mean, it was really a cool experience. The guy's really nice.
That's
totally
cool.
When he was getting back into his limo or wherever to leave, we were hanging out and he was just kind of shooting the shit with us and singing a cappella.
Wow.
And I really kind of got a huge appreciation for how talented, you know, that dude just has crazy vocal chops.
He's amazing.
Just out of the
he's one of those vocalists where you like him or not. I mean, My Wish I always play is like the mother-son song. It's just, he's a natural. He's got the range and he has the tone. Just such a natural. Yeah, that's really cool, dude. That's a great story.
And those runs, those like Christina Aguilera kind of like runs where it's just, I mean, they just note for note, like just like a guitar player would rip a solo. He's hitting those notes just so intricately in tune, on pitch, and so clearly. And he was just doing it very soft, like just messing around before he left. Just, you know,
just there's only like maybe three or four of us hanging out and talking, and he was saying I guess he's doing he's gonna do another album soon. He was singing up some stuff from that, and I was just like, wow man, I gotta go home and practice my singing a little bit.
We'll do a quick dream segment with you, all right? A few more minutes. If you could tour with any active musician, who would it be?
Ooh, geez, that's a great question. Hold on, let me think about this before I answer it too quickly. Joe Bonamassa.
There you go. Right on, good answer. Have you seen him live?
Yeah, and I just love his style. I mean, there's a few others out there. I guess the one thing I didn't think about Joe Bonamassa is that he'd probably be taking all the solos, though, you know?
True. Good answer. Put together a dream bill for Friday night. So pick the venue here in San Diego and pick two other bands or solo musicians.
Well, Johnny Tarr would be on there, and he's in Wales. I think he moved to Wales, though, or back to England.
It's all good. We're dreaming.
Yeah, it's a dream. Whitney Shea too. She was great. It was a blast playing with her. You know, they're more of a national, but I think he is local. Carl Denson, the Tiny, they're incredible. I love listening to them.
Awesome. And what's your venue locally? What venue would that be at? What's your venue of choice here in San Diego?
Man, it's kind of a tie between the Belly Up and Winston's.
Cool. Yeah. I saw you do some video at Belly Up recently, right? You shot some video there?
Yeah. Cool. Yeah, I did it for this organization called Adapt Movement. They basically, awesome. It was a fundraiser for them, and they do, try to help people like relearn how to use their whatever handicap.
Sure.
So people have been, that lost, the use of their arm or something. It's a really cool organization to look into, and basically they did like a streaming concert with other things, but I was the entertainment, and they filmed it at the Belly Up, and it was an awesome experience. That was my favorite streaming kind of gig that I had during this whole time.
Very cool. Moving on with our dream segment here, if you could bring a musician back from the dead for one final concert, man, you mentioned Hendrix, obviously. You mentioned Stevie Ray Vaughan.
Stevie Ray Vaughan.
Yeah. Yeah, died in a plane crash, right? What, 30s?
Yeah, the saddest part is, he struggled with drugs and stuff, and he got clean, and he did that Carnegie Hall show. I'm going to probably screw this up and get some hate mail, but I'm pretty sure that's that chronology. And then right when he's got all these amazing things going for him, and he's clean, and probably had so many more great albums, and that's when he died, But I think that I just saw on, I just read about it, that song Little Wing, Jimi Hendrix's Little Wing. I think his version of it is just, that's probably one of my favorite guitar pieces ever. And I guess he did that in one take. It was just one take in a studio.
Wow. Does not surprise me. That guy's, his licks are just incomparable.
Yeah.
I would have to say best blues guitarist of all time.
Yeah.
Easily.
Yeah, kind of agree with you.
Yeah, great answer, dude. Good answer. Or Hendrix. Or how about both of them, bro?
Oh, together. The only thing is, like, when Hendrix did that thing where he just, like, did a bunch of acid and then, like, just kind of, like, burned his guitar. I don't know. Like, I didn't really want to see that. Like, I...
Heartbreaking.
And that's what killed him, too. That's what, like, depressed him, is he did that a couple times in an organic kind of, feeling the whole, like, hippie vibe of the time. But then people were like, oh, did you see him do that? And then his label told him he had to do that every time, and it just screwed everything up. And I think that's what really depressed him, because of course he was an incredible guitar player.
Right.
But just smashing your guitar and burning it.
Yeah.
It's like, I see what you mean.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I see what you mean. I watched his death anniversary just passed, and I watched a little video about the night he died, and they claimed that they had to pump gallons of red wine out of his lungs from his body. Yeah, so I don't know the actual cause of death for Jimi Hendrix, but...
Yeah, that's a conspiracy I heard. Yeah, some people say he was like, murdered and...
Crazy.
But I don't know. I know that he did. There were interviews where he was like, he was bummed out. He was bummed that... he was almost turning into like a gimmick, you know, because he really was the definition of an artist. I mean, his songs, not only could he play the guitar, but his songs were every, I mean, I play so many of his songs in my set. And and Stevie Ray Vaughan, I love Stevie Ray Vaughan, but he wasn't as really a songwriter like Jimmy was.
Right.
You know, so that's the thing about music is it's there's so many facets to it. There's songwriting and then, like Bob Dylan is a great songwriter. I can't stand listening to him play his own songs.
Oh, really? I love Bob Dylan.
I saw him live, both Bob Dylan and I think it was Kris Kristofferson. I saw them both live in, I used to play Jazz Fest every year. I was in San Diego, or in New Orleans, excuse me. And I heard someone playing, because I'm with you. I absolutely love Bob Dylan. I love all his songs. But I thought someone was up there like, I was like, did someone like sneak on the stage? They're like, is someone like trying to like disrespect him? I couldn't believe it. And it was him. It was just so out of tune and like literally like the guitar was out of tune. And I couldn't believe it. And then same thing with Kris Kristofferson. But then I've heard him other times on live shows, like not in person, where it was really, really good. And obviously the recordings are really good. But it doesn't matter because he's the songwriter. Just like I'd say like Christina Aguilera is an incredible singer, but I don't know as a songwriter. You know what I'm saying? Like there's different, every musician has like their strengths and their weaknesses. And there's only a few of them out there that can do everything like Stevie Wonder, you know?
Yeah, absolutely, man. I would even put, well, I mean, there's a lot of great singers, songwriters, but you know, for modern day pop, Taylor Swift comes to mind.
Yeah.
I mean, I believe she's writing all of her songs, and you can't argue that they're great pop songs. I mean, whether they're your taste or not, you know what I mean? But
shake it off, baby.
shake it off. I think she writes all of her stuff, but yeah, anyways. Yeah, Bob Dylan, I saw him at Humphrey's about 5 years ago, and he was just mumbling, and he didn't play any of his hits. I think he played Blowing in the Wind, but he totally rearranged it so you could barely understand it. He's got that real rebellious attitude, right? A little bit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's what it is. I mean, and I'm definitely not trying to talk shit on it. I'm just thinking from a musical perspective. It's like,
yeah,
you know, it's just, it wasn't in tune and it wasn't in time and it was just, maybe that's what it was supposed to be artistically. Right. I don't know. I mean, maybe that's the whole point. I don't know. But then you hear somebody like George Benson or somebody who's just like sing and play the guitar like a lightning bolt and writes, you know, incredible songs and does all three at once. So there, but obviously you can't compare the two because their songs are totally different. So totally. It's all just what sings to you and what moves you and recognizing that artists are artists and everyone's got something to kind of offer, you know, to bring to the table, in my opinion.
Right. Music is very subjective, which leads us into this next question. If you could wave a magic wand and make one band or artist never exist, who would it be?
Oh.
And not to hate, but who's someone maybe that you're not into or maybe a genre that you're not into?
You know what I can't get into? Mumble rap.
Yeah, I'm there with you.
Like Drake, like how he won like every single, and I just tried to listen to it and I'm sure, maybe like, the kids are gonna be like, "Oh, you're 37. That's why."
Yeah. We're like our parents were to Elvis. You know what I mean, or our grandparents were to Elvis.
Yeah, exactly. So maybe that's all that is. I actually love rap, and I love like hip hop, and especially the old stuff where you could understand the words.
Yeah, I mean, for me, it doesn't get any better than like the Tupac, Biggie, Snoop.
Oh, right? Yeah.
You know, I think you'd probably agree, but we're similar age.
Yeah.
But yeah, good answer. Yeah, the Tech 619, I think it is.
I can't stand it.
We'll take him out now. I tell a nigga, don't dick ride, don't
blink. Yeah. Kanye West, I'm not really a fan. You know,
that's a can of worms. Yeah.
That's a can of worms. Yeah. There's been times in my life where I hated something and then I grew to love it. Like, you know, I hated jazz. When I was a kid, jazz was nails on a chalkboard and I got my degree in jazz. When I was studying music in New Orleans, pop country and country in general was nails on a chalkboard. Met my
girlfriend, now wife, and that's all she listened to. Yeah. I joined a country band, like a Southern rock country band back in the day in San Diego called the Tail Chasers, and we played for, and now I, you know, I still don't turn on the pop country channel, but the old country is, I'm totally in love with, like, especially like the Nashville guys, like Johnny Hyland and Brent Mason and, you know, and all the old country singers. I just adore it. So you grow to love certain things. And I think that's how I'm,
there you go.
That's why I would never say like, I hate this. I just need to like give it some time because right now it's not my first choice.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah. I'm sure you have a new love and appreciation for Rascal Flatts, right?
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. Of course I got to get some of those songs out of my ear because they were haunting me for a while there.
Just what a cool experience. Dude, a pleasure talking with you, bro. One last question for you, Ryan. Where would you like to be in 5 years?
Oh, geez, that's a great question. I would like to be in 5 years, you know, growing, kind of staying on the course, and maybe have another album out by then, and maybe continuing to play some of these bigger shows. I love the momentum. I love the path I'm on. I just, in 5 years, I'd like it to, you know, accelerate a little more and have some opportunities to play on some bigger stages and continue, you know, fulfilling some of these inner dreams, you know.
So it seems like you are, from my perspective. You've really stepped up during these trying times in the music industry. So congratulations. Keep it up, brother. RyanHillerMusic.com, at RyanHillerMusic on Instagram. Are those your platforms of choice?
Yes, they are. Yeah. And that's another goal, is to figure out Instagram, because I'm terrible at it. But I will get it. That's on my to-do list, baby.
It's all about the hashtag, bro. It's all about the hashtag. Yeah. What is your favorite song you've written that will end this episode?
Oh, geez. It's like asking, it's a tough one. It's like, what's your favorite color? I'd say there's a couple songs around. So Fast As We Can is off of Big Medicine, and there's some lyrics in there that kind of, you know, are a little relevant. And then there's a song called Push a Little Harder that I've been playing a ton this year. That was off of How It Works. One of my popular ones, we did a music video, Always Gonna Be Something. It's just kind of like, you know, not one of my more deep songs lyrically, but it's just kind of a fun song. And there's a couple lines in there that also do apply to the year 2020. So
right on.
I'd say it's a tie between those three.
You couldn't pick one, could you? It's like picking your favorite kid. It's like, hey, Ryan, which? A little bit.
It really is.
So we'll do the last one. Always Going to Be Something. Was that the name of it?
Yeah. So you're going to post it? I would say let's do the new one, Fast As We Can.
Fast As We Can. We'll end this episode with Fast As We Can. Ryan Hiller, real pleasure chatting with you, buddy. We'll release this in a couple weeks. I'll send you the link, and we'll keep in touch, man.
Real pleasure. Thank you for your time, my friend. We'll hopefully see you in person one of these days.
Sounds good, dude. All the best to you and your family, man.
I believe in the one wholehearted system. I believe in John's simple line. And I don't believe in fairy tales or the information coming on through the line. Well, I believe that people are equal. Cause I believe we all came from the same ground. And I don't believe in the hatred spewing from the mouth of all these clowns. We are all spinning around. We are all from the same land. As fast as we can. People, why do you do this to each other? Human nature is as wild as the way it sounds. And people, why do you justify, horrify, glorify, and frown? Well, people, why do you do this to your homeland? We're all stuck on the same rock until the day we die. Still we burn through the veins and the valleys that keep us alive.
Palapalooza. Hey!